God's worthy of all of our praise and all of our honor. God's been better than you than what you're praising him for right now. There's a handful of us in here, but we ought to be clapping our hands and lifting our voices, declaring God's glory in this place. Hallelujah. And those of you who are watching us, those of you who are tuning in via cyberspace, you ought to be giving God glory, for he is the King and he is our Lord and our Savior. He is our way maker. He is our all in all. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah in this place. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, good morning. Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. We honor and reverence the spirit of our Christ, and we greet each and every one in the name that matters most, and that is the matchless and majestic name of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. The Bible is right when it declares there's no other name under heaven whereby men can be saved. And so we're thankful to be the recipients and beneficiaries of everything that comes in and with the name of Jesus. There's still healing in that name. There's still salvation in that name. There's still breakthrough, blessing, elevation, and anointing. It's all in the name of Jesus. Welcome to the TCI experience. Worship has been powerful today. The arts ministry here at TCI is second to none. And even as you were blessed by the ministry of the word in song and in dance, know that the Lord is even in our midst, and he has you on his mind, and that every expression of worship is tailor-made for you, the people of God, to be encouraged and inspired concerning God's thoughts toward his thoughts towards you of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. God has the best in mind for you. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah in this place. I'm honored and I'm privileged to be connected to such gifted and anointed men and women of God that the Lord has planted and placed in this ministry. And so glad to be connected to you all around the world, those of you across this nation, and those of you here in the city of Charlotte, those who are members of the best church this side of heaven, Temple Church International. We miss you. We are looking forward to you coming and sharing with us, even as the doors of the church will be open soon. I mean, literally, will be open soon, so the people of God can come together and share in this space and in this time. Well, let's get into the word. Look with me, if you will, at the Gospel of John, chapter number 21. John, chapter number 21. And I want to begin reading at verse number 1 in the New International Version. I need you to understand that we are preaching and teaching the vision of Temple Church International, sharing with you what the Lord has given us by way of mission and vision. Very simple, very simplistic, nothing real deep. But we believe that it is the word of the Lord for this house. Number one, we're the people that get to know God better through worship, devotion, praise, both corporately and individually, both publicly and privately. We believe that we are connected to God through our worship, through our praise, through our devotion to him. We hear from him, and then we talk to him, and so that he can hear from us. That is a core value. Number two, we're the people that get to know one another better. We are emphasizing, focusing on what is known as koinonia. Koinonia, which is fellowshipping within the spiritual community, people of God coming together, not only for the purpose of fellowshipping, but joining our gifts, our anointings, our abilities, our talents, all that God has invested and placed in us, joining those together to advance his kingdom in the earth. And then, of course, we're the people. And this is our vision. It's really just one statement. We are the people that help the world to get to know God better through us, that through evangelism and outreach, we can literally accomplish the Great Commission. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, teaching them whatsoever things the Lord has commanded us. And lo, he'll be with us always. Somebody ought to shout always. Always. Even to the end of the earth. John chapter 21. I want to do part two. Man, is this part two or part three? I can't remember. Part two or part three on this whole idea of miracles. Of miracles. And I know it might seem strange that we're sharing on miracles in this time and this season in which we live, where we are witnessing the perpetual acts of abuse of police officers against people of color, in particular black men and women. And it seems that it is a malignancy, and it continues as we are experiencing a pandemic that has run rapidly across the length and breadth of this nation and around this world. Hundreds of thousands of people dying, and thousands more dying as the days go by. But I am of the conviction that to see an end to all of this, it will take a miraculous move of God. At some point, we're going to make readily available to you a series that I preach entitled The Exodus, where literally we prophesied and predicted what would happen and why God would do things the way that he did those things. He's still the God of the Bible. Y'all a bit reticent. Y'all a bit tentative in replying to that. I said he's still the God of the Bible. And if he could totally dismantle and destroy the systems and structures of Egypt that held his people down, he can do it again. It is not by might, nor is it by power, but it is by his spirit that his will is accomplished in the earth. Oh, God. And maybe that's why I'm talking to us about miracles and belief and frustration and all of those kinds of things, because we tend to forget that he is God and he does not change. The writer says that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. There is no climate that can control his power. I wish I had a few witnesses in here. He is Jehovah Rapha. Let me jump into this. So I want to continue reading. We're in John chapter 21, verse number 1. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I'm going out to fish," Simon Peter told them. And they said, "Well, we'll go with you." So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was him. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you and we praise you for all things. We thank you, God, for your love, your grace, and your mercy. We thank you for the gift of faith, favor, and the forgiveness of our sins. We thank you this morning for this time to share together in this corporate setting for the purpose of worshiping you in spirit and in truth. Worshiping you without limitation, without boundaries, God. Worshiping you, moving away from any darkness, any illusions that we may have had, disillusions that we may have had concerning who you are and what you have power to do. We thank you today and we give you honor and we give you glory. Now, Father, let revelation knowledge flow, share your heart, reveal your mind. In any way you bless us, we'll be satisfied. I ask one more thing, God, that you would anoint me, anoint my mind to think your thoughts, anoint my mouth to speak your word, anoint my body to do your work. And then, Father, I pray that you would anoint those who listen, those who've joined today in cyberspace and in this place, with ears to hear, hearts to receive, minds to understand and apply, and a will to apply and to do what your word instructs. Have your way in our midst. Any way you bless us, we'll be satisfied. It's in Jesus' name we pray and we boldly declare the devil is defeated. God, you are exalted. And Jesus, you are Lord. And all who agree with the prayer of the man of God shouted hallelujah. Amen. And thank you, Jesus. Today, my brothers and my sisters, the message is simply Make Room for Miracles, Part 2. And the subtitle, When God Rewards Frustration with Miracles. When God rewards frustration with miracles. It'll make sense in a minute. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. When God rewards frustration with miracles. Good morning, family. My brothers and my sisters, it has been commonly taught and widely accepted in the church that in order for one to experience miraculous manifestations, all it takes is having enough faith. That is to say, Elder Greer, that where there is no faith, there will be no miracles. I'd like to suggest to you that at best, that sentiment is an incomplete truth. Heavy. Whereas God does at times perform miracles because of our faith, there are other times that he performs miracles to inspire our faith. Let me say that again. Whereas there are times that God performs miracles to reward our faith, Deacon Fat, there are other times that he performs miracles to inspire our faith. And I know I'm talking right, because consider the fact that for 40 years, Israel wandered in the wilderness in a state of disobedience, doubt, unbelief, and unfaithfulness. And for the entire time that they were in the wilderness, every day, God miraculously supplied manna from heaven and a water from a rock. Yeah. Deacon Angie Greer, clearly, the miracles of the manna, the miracles of the water, did not happen because of Israel's faith, but the miracles happened despite their faith. Are you listening? Minister Mary Ty, I'd like to suggest to us that while God does not pity our frustration, he definitely understands our frustration. David says it this way. He knows our frame, and he remembers that we are dust, that God knows that we are human, and that God knows that there's only so much that we can take before we start at least second guessing what God's will is for our lives. He does not pity it, but he understands it. And he invites us to engage in conversation with him about it. God wants us to talk to him when we are frustrated. God wants us to talk to him when, in fact, we don't like what's happening. God wants us to talk with him when it looks like it's over and it looks like things will not turn around. Jesus, in the Garden of Gethsemane, has a conversation with God that helps us to understand this same fact. He says to him, "Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. I know what it is I've been assigned to do. I know what it is that you have appointed me to do." He says, "But despite all of that, I don't like what I'm seeing. I don't like what I'm feeling. And if there's any way you can reverse or change your decision, I would be greatly appreciative of it." Job has the same idea. Job understands that at one point he could take all that he was going through. He understands that even though he lost everything he had and all his family had almost but all been wiped out, Job understood that the Lord gives, the Lord takes away. But at another point, he said, "God, this is too much. And if I can find you, I would call you into question and I would convince you that you got the wrong man." God invites us to have these conversations with him about our frustration. He says through the prophet Isaiah, "Come, let us reason together. Let's have a conversation. Let's talk about this. I want to hear what's on your heart. And I don't want you to fluff it. I don't want you to sugarcoat it. I don't want you to augment it or edit it. I need you to tell me the real, because I desire truth." Somebody ought to shout truth. "I desire truth in the inward parts. I invite you to tell me how frustrated you are. I invite you to tell me how bad you feel. I invite you to tell me how you feel about what's happening in your life. I invite you to talk to me about your problems and your issues that you thought would be fixed by now and have not yet been fixed. I invite you to tell me that you're a little teed off at me and you're a little sideways with me and your jaws are tight because you've been dealing with this thing for too long." Somebody ought to shout, "Yes, Lord." Well, I would like to further suggest to you, my brothers and my sisters, that in 2 Timothy 2:13, the Apostle Paul gives us an interesting alternative perspective concerning God and miracles. Listen to what he says in 2 Timothy 2:13. "When we are faithless, he is still faithful because he cannot deny himself." Brother Willie May, did you hear that? It said that when we who are his followers, when we who are his children, when we, Wanda Nelson, who are his disciples and his students, when we fall over into seasons of faithlessness, he is still faithful. Oh, God, I'm talking betting hours. In other words, he's faithful because he cannot disown himself. He made promises before you got here. He entered into covenant with you before you showed up. And he has this promise, this prophetic word that is hanging over your life. I wish I had a few witnesses in here. A word that is hanging over your life that he says, "I am bound to it. I am bound to perform it." That being the case, what it says is that God does what he does for us because of his faithfulness first and our faithfulness second. You missed that. I said, Elder Colbert, that God does for us what he does for us, first of all, because he is faithful. And then secondly, because we are faithful. There are times that the Father actually does look beyond our fault, Look beyond the fault of doubt. Look beyond the fault of unbelief. Look beyond the fault of unfaithfulness and miraculously meets our needs. Do I have any witnesses that here who has a real transparent testimony? Some of y'all too deep. Some of y'all too laid back. Some of y'all too spiritually advanced to admit it. But there are some of us who shout because, watch this, the God that we serve look beyond our fault, and he saw and met our need. He looked beyond the dirt and saw that he had committed to his plan for our destiny. And despite us, and despite our actions, and despite our wrong turns, and despite our faithfulness and doubt, he did it anyway. Somebody ought to lift your hands and shout, he did it anyway. Consider then the fact, I got to move on. Consider the fact that the previous chapter of the book of our text chronicles three miraculous acts of God in Christ, and none of them happened because of the faith of those that experienced them. They did not happen because of their faith, Milligan. They happened despite their faith. Let me say this again. Three times. In chapter number 20, Jesus performed miracles. God does a miraculous act, and he does it, watch this, outside of the faith of those that he does it for. All right, let me fix it. Can I talk the book for a minute? First of all, Minister Diane Barnes, in the beginning of chapter number 20, on the first day of the week, the text says, somebody shout, the text says, the text says that Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb to spice Jesus's body that it might be properly prepared for burial. She goes to the tomb expecting and believing that Jesus was dead, but when she gets there, he had been resurrected. She did not have faith that he would be alive, but he was alive anyway. Then the 10 disciples were locked behind closed doors because they thought that Jesus was dead. And while the doors were shut and locked, he walks through the doors despite their unbelief, despite their faithlessness. Jesus miraculously shows up, and then they are behind closed doors again. This time Thomas is with them, and they say, Thomas, we have seen the Lord. The women were not lying. We saw him for ourselves. We saw him. It was him. We conversed with him. We exchanged with him. And Thomas said, unless I see the prints in his hand and the wound in his side, I will not believe. And again, with the doors locked and shut, Jesus walks through and shows up and says, Thomas, I know you didn't believe. I know you didn't have faith, but I'm going to perform a miracle anyway. I did not come to talk to those of you who are super faith saints every day of your life, but I did come to talk to those of you who have been living in a season where enough is enough, and your faith has been so beaten and battered, so bruised and worn. Your expectations have been disappointed time and time again, and you're so frustrated that you're about to give up the fight. I see your church face. I see you dressed up. I see you clapping your hands on the internet. I see you acting like you got it all together, but your faith is tested in certain times. That if God don't do something miraculous, you'll throw in the towel. You'll walk away from the fight. But thanks be unto God that not even my frustration can stop God from doing exceedingly abundantly above all that I could ever ask or think. Who am I preaching to in here who says, God, I'm frustrated and I need a miracle. God, I'm frustrated and I need a change. God, I'm frustrated and I need a turnaround. Somebody lift your hand, open your mouth and shout, yes, Lord. In our text then, I don't know if y'all standing up at home. They standing here. Y'all be seated, please. Thank you. In our text, we see Peter, the heir apparent to the leadership of the church that Jesus left in the earth. We see Peter and six other disciples having seen Jesus on two other occasions, and they are frustrated. Check this out, Elder Barnes. They are frustrated, son, because he shows up, but he does not stay. And because Peter is frustrated with Jesus popping in and popping out and popping in and popping back out, he says, I'm going fishing. And they say, the other six say, and we're going fishing too. Please catch this. I ain't got time to really dig and delve into it. But consider the fact that Jesus has shown up two times already. He has shown up, and first there were 10, then there were 11, God have mercy, but now there are 7. Y'all gonna catch this in a minute. There are times that the corporate body of Christ can go through so much that sometimes people who are faithless will not stay in the midst of the struggle and the trial. Oh God, they went from 10 to 11 down to 7. And notice what happens, my brothers and my sisters. When Jesus shows up each time, he leaves. And when he leaves, they go back into their shell. I don't know who I'm preaching to today, but perhaps I'm preaching to somebody who is just frustrated because Jesus keeps popping in and popping out. You prayed a prayer for your child, and they got better for a season. And you prayed again for them, and they got better for a season. And now you got to pray, and they get better, and they get worse, and you pray, and they get better, and they get worse, and you just want them to stay better. All right? Somebody in here knows what it's like to be sick in your body and call on God, and he heals that. But then something else shows up. And then you pray, and he heals that, and something else shows up. And while you're appreciative that he took the headache away the last time, that he took the cancer away this time, that he regulated the blood pressure this time, you would just wish that he would keep you on a place of total wellness and well-being. I see you right now. I see those of you who are watching. You prayed and your marriage was on the rock. It got better for a season, but it seems like every 2 or 3 years, here comes more hell in your home. You prayed and that got better, and here comes something else. You and your spouse are on the same page, and your children acting crazy. You and your children and your spouse are on the right page, and you got some family members who have lost their mind, and you just wish that God would heal this family thing once and for all. Am I talking to anybody in here? And so Jesus is popping in, popping out, and they're frustrated. And Peter says, I go fishing. And they say, I will go with you. Oh, y'all miss what I said. Even the strongest, even the ones who are designated leaders, even those who have the oil of leadership on their lives can get so frustrated that they want to throw in the towel. But I want to speak to leaders who are watching me now. Because of your influence, you can't afford to give up. You can't afford to walk away. You can't afford to throw in the towel. This too will pass. And God's going to reward your frustration by doing a miracle that's going to blow your mind. Is there anybody in here who says, God, I admit that I'm frustrated, but I also admit that you are the God who can do anything but fail. You are the God who can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think. I've seen you do it before. I believe you can do it again, but what I'm dealing with now is wearing me down and wearing me out. And Lord, I believe, but help thou my unbelief. Lift
lift your hands, open your mouth, and shout, yes, Lord.
Please be seated. Thank you. 70. Well, watch this. At times when God will reward your frustration with a miracle. Number one, here's what you need to understand. When you're frustrated, God will at times perform miracles because he wants to prevent reversal and reversion. Okay, all right. God, watch this, will work a miracle in the midst of your doubt, your unbelief, your unfaithfulness, and your frustration, so that he can prevent reversal and reversion. What do you mean, Bishop? I'm glad you asked. Notice what happens. In his frustration, Peter says, I'm going fishing. And the others say, we're going with you. Peter, by trade, is a fisherman. That is what he did in his former life. That was his place of comfort. That was his place of comfortability. That was his zone wherein he felt safe. And notice, because he was frustrated, he said, I'm going back to what I used to do. Oh, God, I've given up on this thing because things are not working the way that I thought they should work, and I'm going back to what I know. Oh, my brothers and my sisters, I got 15 minutes. I got to wobble, wobble, and drop it like it's hot. But please understand, in this season, God will work miracles despite your frustration, despite your unbelief, despite your disbelief, despite your doubt, because he does not want you to go back to where or who you came from. Oh, God. Let me say that again. I said, you are so special to God. The call of God upon your life is so unique. The anointing on your life is so great that God sees in your weakness a tendency and a proclivity to return to the vomit that he delivered you from, the stuff that you got out of your system. And God says, the only way for me to keep them from going back is to work a mind-blowing miracle. Don't look at me in that tone of voice. There's some of you who've been flirting with going back to the old you. There are some of you who've been flirting with taking matters into your own hands. There are some of you who have been flirting with the whole idea that you stop cussing, but you ain't forgot how to cuss, and you're about to tell somebody and give somebody a piece of your mind. But God said, in order to keep you from going back to where I brought you from, I'm getting ready to perform a miracle that's going to make it worth it all. I don't know who I'm preaching to. I don't know who's listening. I don't know who this word is for. But God said, you've come too far to turn around now. You've made too much progress. You've grown too much. You've gone to new heights and new depths. And God said, in order to keep you from returning to the you used to be, I'm getting ready to fix it so you have the
testimony that was coming from me is better than what am I preaching to anybody who's about to go back. But God blocked it. And if you ain't got that testimony, just keep on standing. He's getting ready to do a new thing. And it's going to spring forth now. And you're going to know it when you see it. And your testimony will be, it can't be nobody but God. Wave at somebody across the room. Tell them God's getting ready to perform a miracle. So you ain't got to go back to what was killing you. You ain't got to go back to what was holding you down. You ain't got to go back to what was stunting your growth. You ain't got to go back to what was cursing your existence. Lift your hands, open your mouth, and shout yes, Lord.
So number one, I'm sorry. So number one, perform a miracle in the midst of your frustration. Marilyn Perry, are you listening to me? You gonna do it? St. Thomas, you gonna do it, Brian? You gonna do it heavy? You gonna do it? Because you've come too far from where you started. You've come too far. Turn around now. Somebody lift your hands and shout, yes, Lord. But number two, not only is he going to perform a miracle to prevent reversal and reversion. I love this next point. He's going to perform a miracle, watch this, to remind you of the first miraculous experience you had. He's going to take you back to the landmark of your first miraculous experience with him, because he understands something about recall and recollection. God understands that if he can just jar your memory, that if he can just cause you to reflect upon how he got you out of that, he can raise your expectation so that he can get you out of this. I'm not making it up. It's right here in the text. Somebody tell me to preach. It's right here in the text. The text says that early in the morning, the same morning that they had gone fishing and caught nothing, the night before, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples didn't realize it was him. And he says, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" They said to him, "No." He said to them, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat and you will find some." They did it, and they were unable to haul the net in because of the number of fish. Where did I see that before? I'm glad you asked. In Luke chapter 5, Jesus is standing on the shores of the Sea of Galilee, the same place where this miracle happened, and he's preaching to a multitude. The crowd is so large that Jesus needs to be able to amplify his voice. He looks and he sees boats, and he sees fishermen cleaning their nets. He turns to Simon, who is the CEO of the fishing business, and he says, "Allow me to use your boat." He steps on the boat, pushes out a little bit, begins to speak. His voice projects, and the word of God is received by the people of God. Jesus then says to Simon, "I noticed that you were washing your nets, and you were washing your nets because you were finished, and you were finished because you have not caught anything." He said, "Listen, I need for you to launch out into the deep, cast your net on the right side for a drought, and
Peter says, I'm the experienced fisherman. You're a good preacher, but you know nothing about these waters. But nevertheless, at your word, he pushed out. He threw the net over. And the text says, somebody shout, the text says, he pulled in so many fish that the net began to break. This was Peter's first experience with Jesus. This was James and John's first experience with Jesus. When they met him, he performed a miracle. And Jesus says, I got to bring you back into alignment with my power and my ability. I know you're frustrated, but I'm the same one who told you what to do the last time, and I met the need, and I did it this time too. I wish you would just wave at somebody. Now just tell yourself, self, he's the same God. He's the same one. If he did it before, he can do it again. Everybody in here and everybody watching who has recurring negative experiences, I dare you to remember the first time God worked it out in the midnight hour. I dare you to remember the first time that God turned the doctor's report around. I dare you to remember that God took little and made a whole lot out of it. Who am I talking to in here today? You might be frustrated, but God said, I'm getting ready to take you back to remind you that I have all power in my hand and that I can do anything but fail. Somebody ought to just talk to yourself and say, self, remember, remember, remember. And if God can get you out of that, he can get you out of this. If God could turn that around, he can turn this around. If God could fix that, he can fix this. Lift your hands and shout yes.
Oh, y'all gotta believe it. God, y'all gotta believe. I'm sorry. No. He gonna do it so that you can start believing. So that you can believe on the next level. So that you can have faith like you've never had it before. Number one, he's going to perform the miracle to prevent reversal and reversion. Number two, he's going to perform a miracle to take you back to his ability to turn things around, to fix what's broken, etc. Notice then, number three, oh God, I got to get out of here. Number three, my brothers and my sisters, the Bible says that when they did so, he pulled in a large net of fish. Net was full, and the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. And as soon as Peter heard him, the Bible says he did something really interesting. He put on clothes and jumped in the water. Okay. It's in the book. He put on clothes and jumped in the water. And he did so because someone who was connected to him had insight and knew that in the midst of their frustration, God was in the midst of it all. Oh God, I'm going to tell you the next miracle that God is going to perform in your life. God is getting ready to hook you up with people who will encourage you in the midst of your frustration, so that when you're so far down and so low that you can't see it's him, they can recognize that it's him. Oh God, y'all miss what I said. There are times in your life where you need people to see for you. There are times in your life where you need people who can encourage you concerning the workings of God. And you'll come here for a minute. Help me to preach it, Elisha. The Bible declares Elijah had defeated the prophets of Baal and Asherah on the top of Mount Carmel, and he had prophesied that rain was going to come, but he was so worn out. I'm preaching. He was so worn out about the time and the season of spiritual warfare. Come on, son, we got to get out of here. That the Bible declares that after he had done all he did something real interesting. He tells his servant, go and see, because I hear a sound of rain.
an abundance in my spirit. Now he prophesied it, but he was so depressed that he didn't go look for it. He had to send somebody else. And the Bible declares that the young man came back and said, I see nothing. And Elijah, with his head between his legs, kept telling him, go back again. And on the eighth time, he came back and said, I see a cloud the size of a man's hand. Y'all miss what I said. Elijah was so worn down by the battle that he was fighting. He was so frustrated and so worn out by all that he'd been through that he had somebody else to go see what God was doing. Here's my prayer for you. You need to receive it. In this season of frustration, God's going to anoint somebody in your life with a spirit and ministry of encouragement who will not allow you to give up or go back. Shout yes, Lord. Shout I'm going to close the lesson, but here's the last thing. God's going to perform a miracle in the midst of your frustration, because God, he wants you to understand that he's getting ready to empower you to complete the next season and next assignment of your life. Notice what Peter did, and I'm closing at John's word. The Bible declares that he didn't put on his coat and begin to swim. Now that might not mean anything to you, but the last time we saw Peter on a boat and Jesus on the Sea of Galilee, Peter was walking on the water. But this time he said, because you're so good to me, I walked last time, but I'll swim this time. Somebody needs to hear me. He declared that because you've shown up, I don't mind going through struggle. I don't mind carrying a burden. I don't mind swimming upstream, because I know that it's worth it all. Did you hear me, babe? It's worth it all. Can I go higher? Look at what happened. The Bible declares that when they got to the seashore, Jesus had already put fish on the grill. Y'all miss what I said. The thing that they were looking for, it was already there. Here's my last thing that I want to tell you. Your faith does not make God do anything, but your faith taps in to what's already done. Y'all miss what I said. Real faith does not make God move on your time, but real faith says, God, I trust that it's already done. Can I go higher? I'm going to drop the lesson, but notice this. The Bible says that Peter pulled in 153 fish, and this time the net did not break. I'm getting ready to drop the mic, but I need you to understand that the Lord wants you to know that this next miracle, your net will not break. Your season of losing, your season of having things stolen, your season of having things taken away, your season of missing out, your season of things slipping through your hand, the season is over. Lift your hand. Shout yes. Shout yes. Shout yes. Shout yes. Shout yes. Shout yes. I'm ready for a mind-blowing, boat sinking, make no sense miracle in the midst of darkness, in the midst of doubt. Lord, perform a miracle. Rain on me. Fall on me. Anoint me afresh. Anoint me anew. Move on my behalf. Shout yeah. Shout yeah. Shout yes. Shout yeah. He's gonna do it. He's gonna do it. He's gonna do it. At your darkest, at your lowest, at your worst, he's gonna do it. Shout yeah! Shout yeah! Shout yeah!
We gotta go. I'm done. Done. Trust him. He's about to meet you where you are. These men had walked with him for 3.5 years, and their faith was frustrated. They were about to go back, about to give up. But despite all of that, he performed a miracle. If you'll receive it, I know this ain't what the church been telling you. And you've been squinting your eyes until they're almost sealed shut, trying to muster up enough faith to get God to do something. And God said, maybe in this season, I want to work a miracle to inspire you to have greater faith. Maybe you're watching, you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. You can know him in the free pardon of your sin. Today we offer him to you. Even as he chose Peter, chose his boat, chose his crew, I hear the word of God saying, you didn't choose me, I chose you. And I ordained you. I authenticated you that you might go and bear fruit. Before you were formed in your mother's womb, he knew you. Before you were born, he had already sanctified, set you aside, ordered your steps, determined your future, decided your destiny. Matter of fact, if you can handle this, before you committed your first sin, it was already forgiven. For he is the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. He is the Lamb that was slain from before the foundation of the earth. There's nothing that can make God stop loving you, so don't let there be anything that separates you from his love. Repeat this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, I thank you for this opportunity to give my life to you. I open my heart to you, and I ask you to come into my life. I give you permission to be my Lord, and I acknowledge you as my Savior. I make one confession for every sin that I've ever committed and every wrong that I've ever done. You said in your word, if I confess my sins, you would forgive me, cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Father, I accept the fact that I'm forgiven. I thank you for forgiving me. I thank you for making me clean. Fill me now with your Holy Spirit, with your presence, with your mind, and with your power, that my life might come into the order that you've created me to have. Now, Father, I say in your presence, in the presence of your people, in the face of the devil himself, I'm saved, and I know I'm saved. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, welcome to the family of God. Welcome to the body of Christ. We want to hear of your decision. You can go to our website and let us know. You can go in to our inbox on our Facebook page and tell us about your decision to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. The best decision that you could have ever made in your life. Also, if you want to become a part of our church family, if you want to connect to us, I'd love to be your pastor. We'd love to be your church family. We'd love to help you discover your gift, develop that gift, discover the path of purpose and walk on that path with you and grow and develop with you as we are all going through this life. If you'll hit us up, go to our website, go to our page. There's a form there that you can fill out. And let us know your desire to connect with us. Your family, we'll get back in touch with you. We're excited that you're a part of what God is doing in TCI. Let's look to the Lord. Father, we thank you and we praise you now for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, our hearts have felt. Thank you for your never-ending love. Thank you for hanging on the cross, Jesus, dying and shedding your blood. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your ever-abiding presence. Father, we thank you that you are the God who, in the midst of our frustration, will work miracles anyway. And we receive that truth, that reality, even on today in Jesus' mighty name.